covered the physiology of our respiratory tract, the upper part and the lower part. We covered the physiology of our lungs and the pleura around our lungs. We talked about the respiratory muscles that are used in breathing. So tell me, in peaceful breathing, which muscles are contracted for inhalation, peaceful breathing? Yeah, what's the biggie?
Diaphragm.
Diaphragm, good. And then what other muscles help expand that thoracic cavity? Yeah, the intercostals, you got it. Now, in forceful inhalation, what additional muscles, these accessory muscles, do we engage?
Obliques.
Yeah, your obliques. Well, that's for exhalation, but for inhalation, we use our sternocleidomastoid, other neck muscles, and the pec minors that help expand that thoracic cavity. And then for forceful exhalation, like if we were gonna blow out some birthday candles, we'll engage what?
The obliques.
Yeah, the abs, right? Erectus abdominis and our obliques. Good. So you guys know, and the whole purpose is to make your chest cavity, that thoracic cavity, bigger, and then let it recoil to its normal size. So now we're going to start talking about the physiology of what's going on when that thoracic cavity gets bigger and when it gets smaller. So let's go back to the topic of pressure or concentration gradients. So we know that materials, air being one of them, likes to move down the concentration or pressure gradient, right? So we always go from high and then we go to low. And so for air, for this chapter, we're going to be working with air pressure. So air is always going to want to move from a higher pressure to a lower pressure, always. So the difference between the pressure in our lungs and then the barometric pressure of our atmosphere, like the air out here, is what actually drives our respiration. So when the pressure in the lungs drops lower than it is in the atmosphere, air will flow into the lungs, right? So it's going from high to low. And that's when we inhale. And then vice versa, when at the top of our inhalation, the pressure that's in our lungs rises above atmospheric pressure. And so when we exhale, that's when air will move out of the lungs and out into the atmosphere, going from, again, high to low, just the opposite direction. Does that make sense? So let's walk through this process in all of its steps. So first, we've got the neural control of our respiratory muscles, right? So the brain will send a signal to our intercostal muscles, to our diaphragm, and tell those muscles to contract. So they will then enlarge the rib cage cavity, so that thoracic cavity will get bigger when those muscles contract. And then now attached to the inner part of our rib cage is that parietal pleura. Okay, you guys remember the tissue that surrounds the lungs are called the pleura. And there's an outer layer called the parietal pleura, and there's an inner layer called the visceral pleura. The parietal pleura is actually attached to the inside of your rib cage. So the visceral pleura, the inner layer, is attached to the lung tissue. And it actually clings to that parietal pleura because of a thin film of fluid that's in between. Who can tell me what that area is called between the parietal and the visceral pleura?
Is it the pleural cavity?
Got it, the pleural cavity. So there's a space filled with fluid that's in between the visceral and the parietal pleura, called the pleural cavity. So the pleural cavity, since it's basically sealed off, it has its own negative pressure, and it's called intrapleural pressure. So when the ribs expand and pull that parietal pleura out, the visceral pleura clings to the parietal pleura because of this drop in pressure in that pleural cavity. Does that make sense? It's almost like suction. There's a space that creates this suction between the visceral pleura and the parietal pleura. And the bones that are being pulled by the muscles are what are pulling all of that apart. So now the visceral pleura is attached to the lung tissue, right? And so this is going to cause the lung tissue to expand as well. And it kind of pulls the lung tissue out. And it creates bigger spaces within that lung tissue. And so this causes the pressure in, say, the bronchi and the alveoli that are inside the lungs to also go down. And so this is called, the pressure that's inside the bronchi and the alveoli is called intrapulmonic pressure. So you have an intrapleural pressure and you have an intrapulmonic pressure. So all of this is going to drop because of this expansion in the volume or the size of those areas. So all of this expansion causes this low pressure inside the lungs that becomes lower than the atmospheric pressure out here, right? And so air, because it likes to move from a high to a low, it's going to basically go from that higher atmospheric pressure and rush into our lower atmosphere, the lower pressure, within our intrapulmonic area. Does that make sense? So it's kind of mechanical. It's a little bit, I would say chemical, but it's primarily mechanical. We make the space bigger, and that lowers the pressure, and then air will go in. So if you remember blood pressure, it's also kind of regulated in the same way. If our blood vessels are smaller, if that space is smaller, the pressure is higher, right? And if the diameter of our vessels are bigger, then that pressure is lower. Same thing with like a water hose. A constricted water hose will have high water pressure coming out of it, and then a bigger, larger diameter water hose will have a lower pressure of water coming out of it. Same thing in your thoracic cavity. If it gets bigger, then the pressure goes down. So our muscles expand the space in the lungs, makes that inner pressure drop, and then the higher atmospheric pressure makes that air push right into it. So now we've filled all of our bronchi, we've filled all the alveoli with tons of air molecules, which then increases the pressure within. Okay? So air is rushed in. And so now the pressure is climbing in our lungs. So now the high pressure inside of our lungs is eventually higher than the atmospheric pressure outside. And so which way does the air want to move now? Got it. Out, right? And so normal expiration is a passive process where the diaphragm and the intercostal muscles just relax, and the thoracic cage recoils back to its original size. And then the lungs are compressed by the bones, the rib cage, and it flows down the pressure gradient from the lungs out to the atmosphere. Okay? So let's watch the video that walks through this process of inspiration and expiration.
Air moves in and out of the lungs because of a pressure gradient. When pressure within the lungs drops lower than atmospheric pressure, air flows into the lungs until the two pressures equalize. When pressure within the lungs rises above atmospheric pressure, air flows out of the lungs. Pressure within the lungs depends on the action of the skeletal muscles of the trunk, particularly the diaphragm and the intercostal muscles. Inspiration begins when the intercostal muscles contract, pulling the ribs up and out, while the diaphragm contracts and moves downward. This enlarges the chest cavity in all directions. The parietal pleura, which is attached to the ribs, has a suction-like effect on the visceral pleura, which covers the lungs. As the parietal pleura expands, it pulls fills the visceral pleura and the lung with it. When the lungs expand, the volume of air in the lungs spreads throughout the enlarging space. This causes the pressure within the bronchi and alveoli, called intrapulmonic pressure, to drop. When intrapulmonic pressure drops lower than atmospheric pressure, air flows down the pressure gradient into the lungs. Whereas inspiration is an active process requiring the use of muscles, normal expiration is a passive process resulting from the recoil of healthy lungs. In expiration, the diaphragm and external intercostal muscles relax, and the thoracic cage springs back to its original size. The thoracic cage compresses the lungs, causing intrapulmonic pressure to rise. When intrapulmonic pressure rises higher than atmospheric pressure, air flows down the pressure gradient and out of the lungs.
Make sense? Cool. All right, quiz question. When pressure in the lungs drops lower the atmospheric pressure, what occurs? So there are many factors that can affect this ease of airflow, this movement of the thoracic cage getting bigger and the airflow moving into the lungs and so on. And so we're going to just talk about two of them here, but there are several factors. So first of all, let's talk about pulmonary compliance. So this refers to the elasticity of the lung tissue. It's got to stretch, right? And so if it's not elastic, if it's stiff, then it's not going to have compliance. It's not going to be able to spread out and get bigger. And so ventilation cannot occur unless the lungs and the thoracic cage can stretch and then eventually recoil. So diseases that cause scarring to our lung tissue and make the tissue stiff, such as like tuberculosis or black lung disease from asbestos, they cause the scarring in the tissue that makes the pulmonary compliance decrease, and therefore they have a difficulty breathing because of that scarring in the lung tissue. Alveolar surface tension. This is our second factor that can affect the ease of airflow in and out of the lungs. So if you guys remember, the inner surface of our alveoli is covered with a thin film of water, okay? And this is what is necessary for oxygen and carbon dioxide to actually exchange across the membrane from the alveoli to the capillaries and back. So if left alone, though, water molecules will eventually pull together and they'll collapse the alveoli. This is because water molecules are electrically attracted to one another. This is why water collects in puddles in the street. When you spill water, you get these bigger puddles rather than little droplets. And so this can happen inside the alveoli. So what does the tissue in the alveoli secrete to prevent this from happening? Yeah, surfactant. So surfactant is a lipoprotein, meaning it's like a fatty and protein together. And so this is like, it's like oil and water. It breaks it up. And so this will break up that water surface tension to keep that alveoli from collapsing in on itself, okay, because of the water attraction to other water molecules. So if this is disrupted, obviously, the electrical attraction of those water molecules will cause them all to join in, and then that alveoli will eventually collapse and therefore prevent gas exchange. So in any environmental toxin, like smoke, pollutants, particulates in the air, chemicals, any of those things can cause damage to the pulmonary tissue as well as your alveolar surface tension. So this is where we end up with, you know, different pulmonary diseases from those types of toxins. And so then obviously breathing is hindered because of the degradation of these two factors. So now how do do doctors and clinical exercise physiologists, which is something that you guys could become with your degree. How do they know if someone is breathing is actually impaired or not? So there is a device, it's called the spirometer, and you can be hooked up to a metabolic cart. So have you guys seen pictures of a VO2 max test or been in a VO2 max test? There's like the mask and you exercise, you breathe through the tube into the computer, blah, blah, blah. So you can hook a spirometer up to that that can measure the volume of air as well as the force of your exhalations and your inhalations. And you can get these, you can quantify your breathing, whether it's impaired or not impaired. So here are some measurements that a spirometer can take. So first of all, you've got tidal volume. So tidal volume is the measurement of air that is inhaled and exhaled during quiet breathing. So what you're doing right now is using your tidal volume. And so the volume is measured in milliliters. And so it's going to be this peaceful inhalation, peaceful exhalation, the volume of both of those. Now, I want you to take a deep, forceful breath in. Okay? So inspiratory reserve volume is going to be the amount of air that is inhaled using maximal effort minus the volume of your tidal volume, okay? So inspiratory reserve volume is basically the difference of the amount of air that you inhaled minus the tidal volume, okay? Now if you take a deep breath in again and then forcefully blow it out, more air went out, right, than just when you're peacefully breathing. So that's gonna be your expiratory reserve volume. So this is all that air that you exhaled forcefully, not peacefully, minus the air that you exhaled in tidal volume, okay? The extra on the end when you forcefully breathe or exhale. So air will actually remain in your lungs after you exhale to ensure that gas exchange continues. And so this is called residual volume. It's same like the residual volume of blood that ends up in your left ventricle after contraction. So you have a residual volume of air left in your lungs after you exhale. And so a normal residual volume is about 1,300 milliliters. So now, if you were to add up your tidal volume and your inspiratory reserve volume and expiratory reserve volume, you would get what's called your vital capacity. This is the how much air can move in and out with forceful inhalation forceful exhalation. It's tidal volume plus inspiratory and expiratory reserve volumes. So now if you were to add the residual volume to that whole equation, so residual volume plus vital capacity, that's considered your total lung capacity. So add all of this, add this up, and you're gonna get your vital capacity. Add this to this, and you're going to get your total lung capacity. Make sense? So now that we have a picture of how air actually moves into and out of our lungs, now let's go deeper and focus on the molecular level, those oxygen and those carbon dioxide molecules. So remember, these molecules always want to move from an area of high pressure to an area of low pressure. So how do you know what the pressure is, or the difference of pressure is, between one area and another area? And so what you got to do is you have to measure what's called partial pressure, okay? So this is basically where the contribution of a single gas molecule to the air is multiplied by the air pressure. So let's talk about this. So oxygen, the contribution of oxygen to our air, no matter where we are, sea level or Gunnison, is going to be around 21%. Okay? It doesn't change between sea level and Gunnison. Now the contribution of carbon dioxide to our atmosphere is going to be around 0.03%, okay? actually changes between sea level and altitude is going to be barometric pressure. So sea level barometric pressure is 760 millimeters of mercury. In Gunnison, it's quite a bit less, 574 millimeters of mercury. So now you got to calculate what is the partial pressure of, say, oxygen, and what is the partial pressure of carbon dioxide. So how you do that is you multiply the barometric pressure by that percentage of contribution of that gas. So to figure out what sea level is, who's got their calculator? Multiply 760 times 0.21. What is the partial pressure of sea level of oxygen?
159.6.
Good. 159.6. So how you would write that is it's going to be PO2. So partial pressure of oxygen at sea level is 159, what did you say, 0.2?
Yeah, sure.
That's all right. So now, what would be the PO2 of Gunnison? Driving force of oxygen at in Gunnison versus the driving force of oxygen in sea level.
Driving force has a...
So the driving force is that pressure gradient. Atmospheric pressure versus the pressure in your lungs. And so oxygen is going to move faster and more, or it's going to move faster down a pressure gradient of a greater difference. Your lung pressure is going to be your lung pressure, okay? So if sea level is 159, it's going to be greater, the greater driving force than Gunnison's partial pressure of O2 at 120. This is why it's hard to breathe when you move to altitude. Because there's less driving force of oxygen to the lungs. So what does our body have to do to compensate? What happened? Who moved here from sea level? What did you feel like the first few weeks?
I couldn't breathe at all.
Yeah.
Almost passed out every day in practice.
Yeah, you're short of breath, right? Was your breathing rate faster?
I don't know, but I just...
You always felt like you had to keep breathing more. It was like a very deliberate thing, right?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Because your body's compensating because it's not getting the driving force of the oxygen anymore that it was getting at sea level. So you're like, okay, well, now I'll just breathe more and breathe more rapid and breathe deeper to get that oxygen in. Your body still needs the same amount of oxygen, right? So that's just an acute adaptation that we do. Our ventilation goes up, okay? We're talking about the respiratory system, so we'll talk about that. Eventually, chronically, your body will adapt via erythropoiesis. You guys learned that in the blood chapter, so that you have more carbs to draw to carry the oxygen around. And then your ventilation won't be as rapid and as labored.
So our bodies work like extra hard in altitude.
No, some stress is good for you, actually. It's called eustress. So tonight, when you guys are listening to these seminars, think about this. Think about what acute exposure to altitude does to you and how it may affect a bunch of other things. Chronic exposure is going to have some level of stress, but your body will adapt to that using, you know, erythropoiesis. There's a bunch of other more chronic adaptations, but the think about, at least just in the ventilation, because you guys are learning that now, and then erythropoiesis, that might play a part in a bunch of other aspects in your life. So altitude can affect things you may not think about. Make sense?
So is that why everybody's like, not everybody, but like a lot of people here are skinny, or like...
Yeah, who lost weight when they moved here?
I lost like 20 pounds.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, so your body's working a lot harder. Also, because of the decrease in oxygen availability at your tissues, you become more glycolytic than aerobic, more anaerobic than aerobic. You end up burning a lot more energy than you would at sea level until you adapt. So then think about like the muscle building protein. That's another seminar tonight. Because of this increase in energy expenditure just existing at altitude when you first move here, how would that affect all those other things? There's a lot that goes on physiologically with altitude. And we live at enough altitude for that to be very noticeable. Like 4,000 feet, you may feel it a little bit, like Grand Junction, like 4,500. You may feel it a little bit compared to sea level, but not nearly as much as you would feel it at 8,000 feet here in Venison. And then as you continue to go up, it gets even greater effect.
Crispy's not allowed to host cross country meets.
What?
Crispy High School isn't allowed to host cross country meets.
Really? In high school?
Because
everyone's going to be at a disadvantage than them.
And those kids like get hurt.
Oh yeah, they could get hurt for sure.
Pueblo has kids come up with
kids. What was that?
Schools from Pueblo kids like far over.
Oh, I bet. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, it's intense. It's a lot of stress. And then if you were to put the stress of trying to perform at your highest level on top of that and not being adapted, yeah, some pretty detrimental things can happen. You got to increase your energy intake.
Oh, Jesus.
Because you're burning more than you are taking in.
What elevation do you think you like stop?
Acclimating? Well, it's over a period of time. So your acute adaptations will happen within about a week. And then chronic adaptations is very individual. Some people will feel fully adapted by like a couple months. Some people say 6 months. Some people say up to a year.
Would you go and like get used to living at 20,000 feet, or would you just start?
Well, there's a certain, like above 10,000, living above 10,000 or being above 10,000 is going to have an even more exaggerated effect on your body. And this is why, like, people that climb, you know, the big mountains in Himalayas, they end up having a lot of muscle wasting. They end up significantly thinner, not just fat mass, but muscle mass loss due to their time at that high altitude. It's pretty dangerous to live at that unless you are, which is crazy, this is a really cool, interesting study, the natives that live in Nepal and Tibet, you know, the live in Kathmandu, they live at, I don't even know what the elevation is there, but 12,000? I'm not sure. Don't quote me on that. I never Googled it. But yeah, it's, you know, they're very different genetically than people that haven't grown up in those, their generations haven't grown up in those areas.
So if you develop at like 10,000 feet, are you using the same energy if you were to develop at sea level?
I think it all boils down to your genetics there. So next week, Duncan's going to do a presentation on that, basically that concept of what is it like to grow up at sea level versus grow up at altitude. So he grew up, I think, in Silverthorne, and then he's really interested in this topic just because of, you know, what does it mean? You know, if you were born and raised at altitude, you were born and raised here in Gunnison. Yeah, is there something different about you compared to someone at sea level? Can you acclimate better? Would you have a massive disadvantage at sea level, just like the massive disadvantage sea level has to come to altitude? Who knows? There's a lot of questions around that concept. So next week, that'll be the next topic. So. All right. So let's move on. Now that you guys understand, you know, why it's hard to breathe at altitude until you acclimate, is because of this decrease. force due to that decrease in barometric pressure. So the partial pressure of oxygen and carbon dioxide from the air we breathe to the air when it's in our alveoli, to the concentrations, in the pressures in our arterial blood, to our venous blood, are all different. And this is what drives this exchange from oxygen into the lungs, from lungs through the alveoli to arterial blood, from arterial blood to capillaries of the tissue, and then the other direction of CO2 all the way. There's a difference in pressure every way through that pathway. And that's what drives those molecules from one area to another area. So inside the alveoli, the partial pressure of oxygen is greater than it is in the receiving capillaries. And then the partial pressure of CO2 in the capillaries is greater than it is in the alveoli. And that's why when you breathe in, oxygen goes to the blood and CO2 leaves the blood when you breathe it out. So turn to page 352 in your book, and if you don't have a book, get next to someone that does, and let's walk through basically the pathway that oxygen and CO2 will go from breathing it in to the tissues and then all the way back out. Did I say 352? Okay, in this image, let's just follow the arrows. So starting out with breathing in the air from the atmosphere. So your inspired air at this point, this is all at sea level. This book was written at sea level, obviously, because partial pressure is 159. Well, PO2 in the book is 159. So it's going to be different, obviously, in Gunnison. So PO2 in the air, in the atmosphere, is going to be 159, and then the PO2 or PCO2 will be 0.3, okay? So then you inhale, right? And so when the air arrives at the alveoli, the air has a PO2 of 104. It's lost some pressure at that point, and it has a PCO2 of 40. So now on the other side of the alveoli are all those little capillaries, right? And so inside the capillaries, the blood has a PO2 of 40 and a PCO2 of 46. So if the air on the inside of the alveoli, if the PO2 is 104, and then the air and then the PO2 in the blood on the other side is 40, which direction is that O2 gonna go? Yeah, into the blood, right? From the alveoli. Where's the CO2 going to go? Yeah, from the blood to the alveoli. So that's what's going on in the next image here. The difference in partial pressure of O2 and CO2 on either side of that respiratory membrane, meaning between the capillaries and the alveoli, causes that O2 to move out of the alveoli to the capillaries, and then the CO2 to move out of the capillaries into the alveoli. Is where exchange happens right there. So now the blood in the capillaries has a PO2 of 100 and a PCO2 of 40. So now we have all this blood is going to make its way into the heart, right? Because that's where it goes next. It's oxygenated. It's going to go into the left atria, left ventricle, then being pumped out to the rest of the body. Eventually, all of that blood will make its way to the tissue, right? So at the tissue, the cells in the body's tissue have been using oxygen up for energy, right? Meanwhile, and it's producing CO2 as a byproduct of that energy production. So now the fluid surrounding the cells has a PO2 of 40 and a PCO2 of 46. Now remember, up in that middle little note there, the blood is a PO2 of 100 and a PCO2 of 40. So at the tissue level, where's the oxygen gonna wanna go? Of what? Mm-hmm. So the PO2 of the blood is 100, and the PO2 of the tissue is 40. 100 is going to push that oxygen to 40, right? So the O2 is going to go from the blood to the tissues. Now, inside the tissue, you've got a PCO2 of 46, and in the blood, you've got a PCO2 of 40. So where's the CO2 gonna travel? Yeah, from the tissue back to the blood. So this is how you get exchange at the tissues, right? At your cells. So that's what's going on in the next diagram in the bottom middle. So when the blood from the left ventricle with a PO2 of 100 arrives at the tissue with a PO2 of 40, oxygen is going to diffuse out of the blood and into the tissues, and vice versa for the CO2. Now eventually, all that blood's going to make its way back to the heart in the right atrium, right atrium to right ventricle, and then go back to the lungs for reoxygenation. But at that point, that blood, before it reaches the lungs, is going to have a PO2 of 40 and a PCO2 of 46, and then right back up at the top of our diagram again. Does that make sense? So everywhere exchange happens, it happens because of a pressure gradient, whether it's a CO2 higher or an O2 higher in one location versus the other. Got it? It's going to end up being very similar to that unless you have like polycythemia or you're anemic, you have iron deficiency. If you have some sort of complication with producing red blood cells, or you overproduce red blood cells, or if you don't have the iron to build the hemoglobin that are in the red blood cells, that can affect the oxygen concentration in your blood.
So like the oxygen in the blood and tissues, does it change when you go up to like go up in altitude?
Acute, it will change, and that's why you have to keep breathing to keep it where it wants to be. So your blood, you still want an O2 sat, you know, that is going to be, you know, adequate. Like if you were to, you guys ever use a pulse oximeter? They're little things that pinch your finger and measure your O2 sat. So like when you are just resting and you're fully acclimated to Gunnison, you're gonna be anywhere between like 95-98% O2 sat, right? Now if you had just moved to Gunnison, it could drop significantly. You could be at like 80%. Like my mother, when she came to visit me from Texas, when she came this summer, I was taking her O2 sat just for my own geekiness. And she was like, when she was walking around, she was dropping below 80%. And she's kind of unfit, and so that's gonna make a difference as well. And so she would get tired. She would get tired when she climbed stairs, she'd get tired walking downtown. And it was mostly because of this, you know, she was very, very low in O2 sat. But if she were to live here, she would eventually acclimate, and that percentage would go back up to something. Okay. So that oxygen has now entered the blood because of pressure gradient being higher in the alveoli and lower in the capillaries. But what happens next actually in there? We kind of went through this whole pathway, but we're missing a step. So if you think back to your blood chapter, there's a blood cell that's responsible for carrying that oxygen through your bloodstream. What is that cell? Say that again. So hemoglobin is the protein structure within the erythrocyte. So the erythrocyte or red blood cell is the cell. The hemoglobin is that bundle it up protein that actually carries the oxygen. So the cell can carry various amounts of hemoglobin, and that depends on basically your nutrition, male, female, age, a lot of that has a factor on that, fitness. All right, so of all the oxygen that enters the body, about 1.5% actually binding to any red blood cell, just dissolves. So then the remaining 98.5% then binds to the hemoglobins. It's going to happen right away when it reaches those the capillaries outside the alveoli. So this is going to form oxyhemoglobin. Remember, it has a special name when that oxygen is bound to it. Who can tell me the part of the hemoglobin that oxygen binds to? Yeah, the hemi group, or the hemi part of it. So there's four per hemoglobin hemoglobin structure, four hemis, four globins. So four oxygen molecules can be carried by one hemoglobin. There's a bunch of hemoglobins in your red blood cells. All right, so now this oxyhemoglobin travels to the cells and the tissues all over the body. So its job is to deliver that oxygen to that tissue, right? So say you're exercising, it's gonna go to the muscles because your muscle needs that oxygen. Red blood cells taking it to the muscles. So once those red blood cells reach its destination, the bond between that oxygen and the hemi group actually has to be broken before it will actually diffuse across the pressure gradient. So this is where pH comes into play. So pH is acidity, right? A high pH is more alkaline, a low pH is acidic. So arterial blood has a higher pH than the pH of venous blood. And this difference is what causes the bond to be broken between oxygen and hemoglobin. It's what allows the hemoglobin to release the oxygen. So when that happens, when that difference in pH exists, then that bond is broken, and then the oxygen is free as a bird to travel from that higher pressure of the blood to the lower pressure of the tissue. Right? Got it? So oxyhemoglobin travels to the cells, where a difference between venous and arterial pH breaks the bond, and then oxygen will be released, travel down the pressure gradient into the tissues. So now, CO2 that is in the tissues wants to leave, right? And so here's what happens next. So because the partial pressure of CO2 being higher in the tissue and lower in the veins, the CO2 will pass across the membrane and enter the venous blood. Now, only 10% of that CO2 will get dissolved in the plasma, kind of like a very little amount of oxygen just dissolves in the plasma, but it's greater in CO2. So 10% of CO2 dissolves in the plasma. Now, 20% of that CO2 is going to actually bind to the hemoglobin. Okay? Not all of it, not the rest of it. So a hemoglobin that has CO2 bound to it is called a carb amino hemoglobin. When oxygen is bound to it, it's called oxyhemoglobin. When CO2 is bound to it, it's called carb amino hemoglobin. So 20% of that released CO2 is bound to that hemoglobin, causing those carb amino hemoglobins, and 10% dissolves in the plasma. So what happens to the rest of it? There's like 70% of that CO2 left, right? That's leaving the tissues. So that remaining is what actually becomes and binds to what's called your bicarbonate ions. So let's talk about that for a second. So bicarbonate ions are part of your pH buffer system. They're constantly working in one direction or the other, either consuming hydrogen ions or releasing hydrogen ions. And hydrogen ions are what drive pH. More hydrogen ions drop pH, less hydrogen ions raise pH. So when the CO2 leaves the tissue, it's going to bind with water in the plasma and form what's called carbonic acid. Carbonic acid will then disassociate, meaning split back up, but in a different form. So it's going to split back up into a bicarbonate ion and then a hydrogen ion. Now your kidneys play a part here. The kidneys are going to take that that bicarbonate ion and use it for further pH buffering, and then eventually those hydrogen ions are going to be peed out in your urine, and that's what makes your urine acidic. It's uric acid. It's those hydrogen ions that you're getting rid of through your kidneys. So a lot of your CO2 doesn't just get, you know, exhaled, but a lot of it will go and be excreted in other methods. Now, when you exercise, everything changes. And so this is just, if you're in resting conditions, this is kind of what's going on. If you're exercising, you're producing even more CO2 and you're needing more oxygen, and a lot of these reactions change. We'll go into that. Let's just talk about that in X-Phys, at ESS-330. Okay. The primary way oxygen is transported in the blood is what?
C.
Good. Oxyhemoglobin. What's the primary way CO2 is transported in your blood?
Carbon.
Bicarbonate. Yeah. 20% is the carbonate hemoglobin. The majority is that bicarbonate.